Okay, I'm going to call the January 7th, 2018 Public Works Committee meeting to order with roll call.
Mr. Katura?
Here.
Mrs. Meany?
Here.
Mr. Schmitz?
Here.
Changes to the agenda will be removing item number one, our storm response status update. Mike Gilardi was not able to make it to this. He's on a special shift at the service department, so he wasn't able to make this this time. So we do have minutes, two sets of minutes actually, from December 5th, 2018 and December 17th, 2018. We'll need a couple of motions for.
Make a motion to approve the meetings of December 5th, 2018.
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second. Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Okay. Takes us to the set of minutes from December 17th, 2018.
I'll make a motion to approve the minutes of December 17, 2018.
Second.
Motion and a second. Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Under pending, we have none. This will bring us to item number two, the City of Solon 2019 Infrastructure Improvements Report.
How's the committee this evening?
We're doing well. How about you?
Good. Mr. Bush is on vacation tonight, so I'll be standing in for him. Hopefully I can do as well as he does. I can entertain any questions on the monthly construction cost update if anybody has any questions. Everything's fairly new since it's the first meeting, so.
So there's really not too much to report.
Correct.
For those watching at home, it is a it's a fresh slate, and we will as our meetings progress throughout 2019, there will be more to report. Anything else you wanted to point out or anything?
Not at this time.
Okay. Thanks, Bill. And that's going to take us to number three, the 2019 Annual Emergency and Miscellaneous Roadway Repair Contract.
Yes, on December 14, 2018, two sealed bids were opened for the 2019 Annual Emergency Miscellaneous Road Repair. Liberta Construction and Trimore Corporation. Trimore was the low bidder at $378,180. The engineer's estimate for this project was $385,000. We have attached a detailed bid tabulation. I can entertain any questions that the committee has about the bid tabulation at this point. And then I would wish that this, they have no questions. Put this in with an emergency clause so we can, starting March 1st, we can use this contract.
Any questions from the committee? I don't have any. The, you know, the bid tabulations and everything were pretty standard to what we've seen in the committee has seen in the past, and we're very familiar with Trimore as they have performed this contract.
Yes.
In. Let's see, 2011, 12, 16, 17, and 18, and yeah. They've also done our concrete annual as well.
Correct.
Multiple years as well. So with that, is there a motion?
Sure. I'll go ahead and make a motion to have legislation prepared awarding the annual emergency and miscellaneous roadway repair program to Trimore Corporation as the lowest and best bidder. And this is to be done under emergency, and this will be in the amount of $378,180, and the emergency is so we can get the contract in place by March 1st, 2019. Stay in that.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
That brings us to item number four. The 2019 Annual Sanitary and Storm System Repair Contract?
Yes, on December 14th, 2018, two sealed bids were received and opened for the 2019 Annual Storm and Sanitary Repair Contract. Neroni & Sons and Trax Construction. Trax Construction was the apparent low bidder at $20,155. Just so the committee's aware, this project is budgeted for $450,000 for this year. The $24,456 is a comparison bid, so that's not the actual bid for the contract. This is a time and material contract, so we only pay for what we use and the materials we use. with 10% markups with overhead and with material also. Trax has had this contract in the past, I believe 2016, and then they Neroni had it for 3 years before that, so then Trax had it for the previous year, so they're extremely familiar with this contract and I'm confident they're going to do a good job. I do ask that this be considered under emergency also, so we can get the contract in place as of March 1st, 2019.
Bill, I think it's important to note that while they have performed the this contract in the past, the engineering department also did check references, and the references that we received were very favorable.
Yes.
Anything further from the committee?
Trax has also did the Miles Road project and Bainbridge Road culvert, so we're familiar with their work.
Okay. I'll make a motion to accept the bid of Trax Construction for the 2019 annual sanitary and storm system repair program under emergency in the amount of $450,000.
I'll second that.
Okay, just state that the emergency so we can have it in place.
So in order to have the contract in place by March 1st, 2019.
The time at which our current contract will expire. So we have a motion and a second. Proceed to vote.
Mr. Keturah?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmitz?
Yes.
Takes us to item number 5, the SOM Center Aurora Intersection Improvements Contract.
Yes, again on December 14, 2018, three sealed bids were open for the SOM Center Aurora Intersection Improvement Projects. The three bidders were Perk Company, Carvo Companies, and Katz Construction. The total bid base amount, lowest apparent bidder was Katz Construction at $5,965,006.37. The engineer's estimate for this project was $6,250,000. A detailed bid tabulation is attached. We did seek references for this. They came back favorable. Also, Katz has did the Carter Street project and so on. They also did the catch basin repair, and they have been a sub on, believe, the 2017 asphalt annual. A pre-award meeting was held with Katz on December 28th, in which all the questions that we asked them, the answers were favorable regarding this project. In addition to the base bid, there were alternatives to this contract. The engineer's estimate for the alternative bids was $580,000. The alternates are to use Sanitite pipe versus the standard conduit. One of the reasons why we use the Sanitite pipe is it comes in longer lengths, typically for, say, storm sewer, for example, they use concrete pipes, so they're 8-foot lengths. This is eliminating joints, which eliminates sinkholes. Also, Sanitite pipe is a double or triple gasketed pipe versus a single gasket for your concrete or your typical SDR 35 pipe. So we get a better seal and a better product at the end of the day. The fiber concrete reinforcement bid for $14,000 was another alternate. Decorative overhead signals. This is just the extra material costs for the poles, the mass, and the decorative clamshell that goes around the bottom. The alternate for the auto scope video traffic detection, and the decorative pole for the pedestrian crosswalk. Those are the alternates, and we are asking that the committee approve the alternates. The city is being granted funding 90% of the eligible project costs up to a maximum of $1,449,063, and 85% of the traffic signal related costs up to a maximum of $192,598.22. Base bid submitted by Katz Construction, and the city's base bid share for reimbursement will be $4,323,345.15. And will be for 10% of the construction costs, 15% of the traffic related construction costs, and 100% cost to city construction items such as base repairs, curb ramp replacements, sanitary sewer replacement. And the city will be responsible for 100% of the alternate bid costs, which makes up a city total of $4,939,986.15. And given the favorable references that the city received, plus all the projects they did in the city, We're asking that contract 2013.16 be awarded to Katz Construction in the amount of $6,581,647.37. I can entertain any questions that the committee has at this time. Yes, Councilman Meany.
It's been a long time coming.
Yes.
So as much as I think I've voiced in the past, you know, we use the word displeasure, but, you know, kind of that the price kept going up, 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 and up. But, you know, it is what it is. I'm glad that we did get three bids for this. And, Bill, I know you and I spoke today. I did call about these, you know, the alternative bids, additional cost. And, you know, I think I was concerned mostly the big one was the pipe. And I think your explanation, you know, I understood that, you know, to go and to spend an additional almost $95,000 on that made sense. And I think that's, you know, the right thing to do. You know, just spend a little bit more, and I think we'll end up having a better project. And like you said, definitely in my lifetime, it should be. So that's a good thing. And I think my only other comment, and Bill, I know you and I spoke about this, I think because this is such a large project, and being someone who works in a plaza that it's going to be affecting, I think the business owners are concerned, and I know you and I had spoken, you know, about possibly, you know, letters or whatever, kind of just keeping them informed. I think for all of us who have had road projects, you know, residential ones, I think the companies that have done these do a great job, but they keep the residents informed. And I think if people know, you know, when, what, you know, when's this going to happen, you know, when would night work be done? I think that would be, you know, that's just, you know, my kind of two cents on this is to, you know, I think it would be good of the city if we could, you know, like I say, and there's obviously, you know, there's some residents on Aurora, not really too many, but it's mostly just, you know, the businesses, the commercial, the shopping plazas that I think, you know, if we can give them an idea. I mean, obviously weather and all that plays into a project like this, but I think if we can let them know, you know, that I think that would be really helpful.
Yes, we've already been reaching out to Echo and Madamco to get email contacts, not only for them, but for the individual businesses inside there. We can also reach out to the residents and some of the property owners of the apartments on 43 to contact them. And I believe we're going to have a, you know, pre-construction meeting with anybody that's in that affected in that area, so we can have discussions and any concerns can be voiced.
Thank you.
I do have a question with respect to one of the alternates, and that was the fiber reinforcement in the concrete. Maybe you could, or Dan could talk to us a little bit about that. I was, and correct me if I'm wrong, I thought that that was something that was pointed to as potentially having caused a problem with some of the MS concrete in certain projects that we had done throughout the city.
Well, I'll give you my two cents worth, and then I'll turn it over to Dan. Typically fiber, typically when they put concrete in, Dan can correct me if I'm wrong, they use wire mesh in there, and supposed to be midway up in there to hold everything together. Fiber gets throughout the whole cement mix and creates like little fingers that join together, okay, to hold it together. And I know from a personal standpoint, my whole driveway is fiber mesh and I don't have one crack in it, and it's 5 years old. Not to say that I have the road conditions that Solon does, but and typically when we've done projects at the service department, we use the fiber mesh, and we really haven't seen any serious problems. But I'll let Dan answer, give his comments.
Yeah, I would agree with Mr. Dursick. I would just add two things. Is one is that the fiber needs to be mixed well into the cement mix so you don't get balls of fiber, which on a rare occasion I've seen. And then the second thing is the saw cuts. The most important thing is a contractor needs to saw cut one-third the depth, or else if the saw cuts are too shallow, then cracks can develop and travel off of the saw cuts, yet parallel to the saw cuts, you got a crack 3 feet or 3 inches away from a joint. So the only problem I've honestly ever seen that's from a constructability standpoint is not saw cutting deep enough in the fiber. And it's something that our inspectors are asked to check regularly and remind the contractors of too.
So you're both of the opinion that this is in the residents' best interest to spend the...
Well, actually, as I'm looking at this, it's a credit.
It is a credit.
Yes.
I apologize. But my concern also was the fact that I thought I saw a report from, was it GeoSci? When we were having problems with MS concrete aprons. And I thought that that fiber was...
I thought that was more with the Cure, wasn't it?
Yes. Cure, we had a problem with curing compound, either improper and poor reaction from the curing compound. And that was with one particular product called The Cure.
Anything further from the committee?
No, I'm good.
Okay.
Old enough.
Yeah, right. Don't be when it happens. Okay, I'll go ahead then and make a motion to have legislation prepared awarding the bid for the SOM Center Aurora Intersection Improvement Project to Katz Construction in the amount of $6,581,647.37, and this is to be done under emergency in order to start the work as soon as possible.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmett?
Yes.
Just item number six, the Northeast Ohio Regional Sewer District and Cuyahoga Soil and Water Conservation District, the 2019 Memorandum of Understanding.
Yeah, I believe this is something that we do every year. The engineering department's requesting renewal of the attached memorandum of understanding with the Regional Sewer District and Cuyahoga Soil and Water to provide education, stewardship, and public involvement activities in accordance with the city's stormwater master plan. The city entered into a similar memorandum of understanding with the sewer district and soil and water to provide these services in 17 in accordance with the attached ordinance 2017-03. The annual fee, $5,500 to Soil Water Conservation District, will be reimbursed to the city through the sewer district. The city of Solon would utilize this assistance with the sewer district and soil and water to meet requirements for our NPDS permit, which is our stormwater permit for control measures one, education outreach, and control measure two, public participation and involvement. Engineering recommends this legislation be prepared under emergency in order to have the agreement in place as soon as possible, as requested by the Soil and Water District, waiving competitive bidding of codified ordinance 23403 section A to renew the memorandum with Soil and Water in the amount of $5,500 and authorize the mayor to execute the paperwork and furtherances of this memorandum.
We'll make a motion to prepare legislation under emergency in order to have this agreement in place as soon as possible to renew the Memorandum of Understanding for 2019 with the Cuyahoga Soil and Water Conservation District in the amount of $5,500.
Motion and a second. Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmett?
Yes.
Okay. Takes us to item number seven, the Solon Road Reconstruction General Engineering Design Services, Burgess and Nightfall.
This is design services. I'm sure the committee is aware of the agreement that we have with Swage Lock with the work they're going to be doing over there. Part of that agreement is to, if I could have the overhead document camera, is to widen Solon Road in front of their property there. Currently, Solon Road is... with the turning lane roughly from maybe 600 feet to the intersection of Cochran Road. We would extend the turning lane all the way down to their south property line down here, which is close to the park. It also incorporates a multi-purpose path or a sidewalk with that study. So this would be a part of the contract with Burgess and Nyepel that assists the engineering department with general engineering services and projects throughout the city. The engine department is proposing to utilize B&N services to develop the plans and specifications for the Solon Road reconstruction project for Swage Lock that the city is committed to as a part of the job creation grant entered into both parties in accordance with Ordinance 2018-99.
BNN has submitted the attached scope of work and a fee proposal in the amount of $107,100 for this project. Burgess and Nyepel's fee proposed is a base upon the general rates of the engineering and design services contract. And this is a not to exceed $107,100. And I know it looks like a lot of money, because I know that's the next question I'm gonna get. So with that being said, I don't know how familiar you are with this area. There's a pretty significant grade issue there, for one. The berm is questionable at best. So part of the survey and design process is gonna be to do some soil sample borings and things like that. So we can make sure that we have a good, safe, sound road underneath there. Can entertain any questions?
Do we have any issues?
I'm sorry?
Do we have any issues with the roadway now?
Last year, the service department on the south side did significant berm repairs, probably almost across that whole section that you see where it's gonna be widened now. The berm was extremely soft. We dug out probably 2 feet of material, put a new base in, compacted it, and gave it and put a new asphalt berm there. And we do have, since the grade is so significant there, we do have water runoff and erosion issues along the edge of the road there that if we wouldn't have put that extra asphalt there last year, we would have probably had issues with plowing this year. And plus it makes the edge of the road very weak and cracks and then just
cracking
continues.
Perpetuates.
Correct.
More cracking.
Councilperson Meany.
I mean, I understand all you got to do is look at the map and you can see all that, you know, as we always say, Solon, you know, pioneers with web feet, right?
Yep, that's it.
You know,
swamp.
We got
more swamp.
More swamp. And you could really see that, so I can understand that. I guess my one question, Bill, was but they're not going to deal at all with the parts of the sidewalk on F.A. Lennon, correct?
There's a proposal to add, I believe.
It just says here, no survey will be completed for the sidewalk improvements along F.A. Lennon Drive.
Right. I believe that's a physical survey. I don't think that's I think
they're not going to be involved in that's not part of this scope.
Not part of this original scope, because
okay.
I believe at the time they weren't sure if we were going to have to bring a sanitary sewer down F.A. Lennon, because there isn't one there. That's why in the original agreement, I think there was some sanitary sewer language in there. And I believe it included some sidewalks around F.A. Lennon.
And then one other just question, because it's another thing when they're talking about the sidewalks on F.A. Lennon. What's a topographical survey? What is that? Because one of the things they say the city's responsible for is to enter into a contract with a geotechnical engineering firm to provide a geotechnical.
Well, geotechnical is more of or like a soil sample type thing.
Okay.
Where a topographical survey would be your grades.
Okay.
If I'm saying it correctly, chime in, but I believe.
Oh, that's right.
So the top that would be for the grading of
right.
The
yes.
Yeah, your contours.
Okay, gotcha. Okay. All right. But it's definitely a cha-ching, but I mean, I understand that it's not.
And the reason why we're bringing this ahead so early is we don't want to get caught behind the eight ball,
for
because
sure.
We don't want to have construction going on with our project and with Swage Lock at the same time.
Anything further from the committee?
Okay, I'll go ahead then and make a motion to have legislation prepared authorizing the mayor to proceed with the design of the Solon Road reconstruction project for Swage Lock with Burgess and Nyepel in an amount not to exceed $107,100. And no emergency, right? Okay.
Second.
Motion and a second. Proceed to vote.
Mr. Keturah?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmitz?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thanks, Paul. This brings us to item number 8, the National IPA Lawson Products.
Good afternoon, committee. Happy New Year.
Well, Michael, Happy New Year.
I think you're going to spend a little bit of time with us this evening.
I apologize.
Hopefully you have some.
This is over, you know.
But the rumor has it you have some visual aids for us.
I have a few. I know Mrs. Meany enjoys them.
No comment.
First on the agenda is, while we were implementing our new software fleet program, I was checking pricing on some of our expendable inventory that we deal with Lawson's product with, and reached out to them to inquire to see if they were on a national contract. At that time, they were not, and I expressed upon our salesperson that that's important part of our everyday business, and we would like to check into that. So he came back to me, and they actually joined the National IPA along with the U.S. community government, and we do about an annual sales of about $15,000, and they came back with reducing our costs from 24% to 73%. So it's a little bit, but it all adds up over the years. So I would like to see if we can pass it under emergency so we can start realizing the savings right away. We use them almost every day.
So I understand, Mike, so basically this is just for this Lawson Products company?
That is correct.
This legislation is just for them, not going through any of the, okay.
That is correct.
Gotcha, okay.
The cooperative program?
We are already currently with U.S. Communities as a cooperative. Mm-hmm. This is a subsidiary of the U.S. community company.
And I assume you'll still continue to, though, to always periodically kind of just price check?
We do it all the time, yes, ma'am.
Just trying to see how we're going to word this. Okay, we're going to make a motion to prepare legislation to approve under emergency. What is it? Agreement with Lawson Products?
Yes.
That's what it is? Okay.
Yes.
For 2019. Yes. Is there an amount to go along with it? Or?
Well, it's savings. We annually spend about $15,000 with them, but we are going to start realizing between 24% to 73% on the items that we currently purchase from them.
Okay, nothing has to be in the legislation, though. No numbers have to be in the legislation.
No.
The way I'm understanding is we need authorization to participate in this purchasing alliance.
Yes, sir.
So.
Yes, sir.
The legislation
is to accept the national IPA, which we already are part of the U.S. communities.
But this is a subsidiary.
A subsidiary of U.S. communities, yes.
Okay. Mr. Dursick, I think you had something.
Is that line?
No, you covered what I was going to say. The amount in here is already in our budget, realized in our budget, so that we don't need a dollar amount.
Like that. Okay, it's like they said, as outlined in the memo from Mike.
Do I have a second?
Yeah, I second that.
All right, so we have a motion in this.
So much easier.
Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmitz?
Yes.
Okay.
That's going to bring us to item number 9, the mobile columns lifts, twin post lift, and accessories. Now, some of this stuff looked pretty cool. What do you got for us?
We're seeking 6 mobile column lifts with a 19,000-pound capacity, and additional accessories of jack stands and wheel jacks, and a column cross beam. We are also seeking a 18,000-pound twin post lift. The vendor we're using is Chagrin Valley Auto Parts, which is Napa, located on Washington Street in Chagrin Falls. NAPRA is a active member of the Sourcewell Cooperative Government contract, recited there, good until 6 of 2020. Total cost of lifts and accessories are $90,446. Can we show the video so people understand what they are?
It's amazing.
I had these lifts in my previous employer, the city of Parma, and we used them at the fire station, and we used them at our service center. They're mobile. They can be moved anywhere. It'll give us the lifting capacity of vehicles and equipment we're unable to do at this time. Work in a much safer environment. And so I brought this up to the commissioner, and he was all for it. After we had two companies come in and demo the product, we chose this because of the better pricing. The Snap-on Corporation, we checked theirs out. Equally as nice, but more bang for our buck going with NAPA and a local local company we do a lot of business with currently.
So would it be fair to say that having this type of equipment would help you to more efficiently, I guess, more quickly turn things around and get vehicles back in service?
Yes, especially our fire department. Currently, we just have some of the equipment can't be lifted. We don't have the capacity for the ladder trucks and stuff like that. Our loaders and stuff can be lifted. So a much safer environment. Plus, when we our other lifts are being used, these can be used in bays that
other
don't currently have
the
lifts. Correct.
So it can allow you to service more vehicles?
Correct. More efficient and back on the road, yes.
Was there a video for us?
I thought we had a video.
He doesn't have it.
Okay. I apologize. There's plenty of pictures.
Well, that's what I was going to point out. The packet was
very cool.
Yeah, it was packed with a lot of different photographs to illustrate exactly what these were. So thank you for that.
You're welcome.
Okay. I'll go ahead then and make a motion to have legislation prepared authorizing the service department to purchase the mobile column lifts, twin post lifts, and accessories from Chagrin Valley Auto Parts Company in the amount of $90,446.02.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmitz?
Yes. I think we're going to have a field trip to see some of these cool new toys.
You're welcome. Yes.
In action. All right. So you're still up.
I'm still up.
And that's going to bring us to item number 10. We have a Hustler Kubota mower and accessories.
Yes. Service department is seeking two Hustler 60-inch mowers, one 54-inch, one 48-inch, and a Kubota 48-inch turf mowers, grass cutting for our city properties. The vendor is Krastowski Tractor Sales out of Wellington, Ohio, under the Sourcewell Cooperative Government Purchase Program. Contract recited there. The purchase and the remittance for the Hustler is made to the Hustler Turf Equipment Company out of Kansas City, or out of Kansas, I'm sorry, for the sum of $37,731.01. And the Kubota will be made out to Krastowski Tractor Sales Incorporated out of Wellington for the sum of $54.05. Total cost $43,136. Our budgeted was for $45,000, coming under budget at $1,863.99.
I'm okay. Yeah, I think your memo was pretty detailed. Thank you.
All right. Make a motion to prepare legislation to allow the service department to purchase the two Hustler Super Z. Okay. And the Fast Track SDX, as well as a Kubota WH-115 mowers for the service department in the amount of $43,136.01.
And I will second that.
We have a motion and a second. Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmitz?
Yes. Brings us to item number 11, the 2020 International 7400 Crew Cab with dual steer and swap loader hook lift hoist.
Yes. The Department is seeking a new 2020 International 7400 crew cab with dual steer and to be equipped with swap loader model SL412 hook lift, central hydraulics, and also a heavy-duty angling plow, hook lift skid-mounted hopper spreader, 800-gallon liquid pre-wet system. The swap loader will accommodate the new skid-mounted leaf collection unit that we will introduce later. The international chassis with dual steer capacity we purchased through the Rush Truck Center out of Cincinnati, Ohio, under the Ohio Department of Transportation's bid proposal contract. Swap hook and accessories as described will be purchased through the Concord Equipment, located in Painesville, Ohio, under the Ohio Procurement Contract. International dual steer is $107,458. Swap loader accessories and accessories are $122,648. We budgeted $235,800. The total cost, $230,106, coming under budget with $56,9302.
Fire truck.
Committee may recall that we purchased one of those last year. We're going to purchase a second one to accommodate better services in the service department.
Okay. I just said, what is your expected life cycle for this unit?
I would expect 12 to 15 years. It's a multi-purpose vehicle we're going to be using for several different seasons. The leaf season, I'm going to be introducing legislation for two leaf loaders, which will add better service to the city residents. We're also going to be eliminating our truck drop and using the rubbish containers to drop off at the residents instead of the truck drop. And also the salt equipment, a spreader, and brine system. So we can use it all year long for different things.
It's a utility player.
I'll go ahead then and make a motion to have legislation prepared authorizing the purchase of a 2020 International 7400 crew cab with dual steer and swap loader hook lift hoist from two vendors, Rush Truck Centers and Concord Road Equipment, in the amount, the total amount for both in the amount of $230,106.98.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Proceed to vote.
Mr. Keturah?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmitz?
Yes.
Takes us to item number 12, the 2020 International Cab Chassis.
The Service Department is seeking a new 2020 International awarded to Rush Truck Centers of Cincinnati, Ohio, purchased on the Ohio Department of Transportation Cooperative Contract. Additional legislation will follow to equip this asset with salt and ice capacities. Total, $83,687.
All right, we'll have legislation prepared to allow the Service Department to purchase the 2020 International HV507 SFA cab and chassis from Rush Truck Centers in the amount of $83,687.
Second that.
Motion and a second. Proceed to vote.
Mr. Keturah?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmitz?
Yes.
Okay. Item number 13, the dump body and accessories.
If the committee would like, number 16 is the actual truck. And the number 13 is the body. Could we introduce those together? to speed up things, or would you like to introduce them individually?
Committee have an opinion?
Well, I think they're, it probably, are they separate on the, I think they're separate.
They are separate on the.
Yeah, you know, I.
Separate, okay.
Because that's how they're going to, they're separate legislation, so.
The Service Department is seeking new municipal stainless steel dump body with central hydraulics, electric and lighting, snowplow hitch, snowplow, and tailgate spreader. The awarded vendor is the Concord Road Equipment out of Painesville, Ohio, on the Ohio procurement term. This equipment will be attached to the new 2019 Ford F-450 chassis. Total cost of the body is $37,351. The budget for the both truck and body was $85,700. Came in at $70,185.81, an under budget figure of $15,514.
Okay, I'll go ahead then and make a motion to have legislation prepared authorizing the purchase of a dump body and accessories from Concord Road Equipment in the amount of $71,131.99.
Second.
Motion and a second. Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmets?
Yes.
Okay, brings us to agenda item 14, the 2001 International Unit STR-243.
Yes, I was contacted by the service manager at the Solon City Schools asking if the city had any vehicles that we were going to be getting rid of. Consulting with the commissioner, him and I chose unit 243 was going to be slated to be retired and sold off. I spoke to their service manager there, and he spoke with the superintendent, and we agreed talking to the finance department that we would agree to sell the district the vehicle for $1. Along with that would be a snowplow, tailgate spreader, and salt spreader will be attached at the time of sale. Assistant Superintendent Fred Bolton sent us over a letter of intent to purchase that and asking the committee that we pass it on emergency so they could start using it.
Done this before?
We done this before?
I don't know that answer.
Things to
I don't have a problem with it. I'm just.
Have we done that before?
Everybody's okay with it. I'm good with it.
Yes, Bill.
To my knowledge, nothing on this large of a scale. We've given other smaller items to them, but this is the first time we've ever given them a truck. Or sold a truck to him for a dollar.
All right, then we'll prepare legislation to approve the sale of the 2001 International Unit STR-243 and its accessories to the school City of Solon School District in the amount of $1 and set under emergency.
Second it.
We have a motion and a second. Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmets?
Yes.
Okay, item number 15, the Bonnell Spartan hook lift skid mounted leaf collection unit.
Yes. The Service Department is seeking two Bonnell Spartan hook lift mounted leaf collection unit with 20 yard hopper capacity, electric and hydraulic systems, John Deere Tier 3 diesel engine. Collection unit will be purchased from the Concord Road Equipment of Painesville, Ohio, under the Ohio procurement contract, and a total cost of $184,890.16. And those will be attached to the two hook lifts that we are purchasing.
Anything?
Yeah, Go ahead then and make a motion to have legislation prepared authorizing the purchase of a Bonnell Spartan hooklift skid mounted leaf collection unit from Concord Road Equipment in the amount of $184,890.16.
Second.
Motion and a second. Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Brings us to item number 16, the 2019 Ford F-450 4x2 cab chassis.
The department is seeking a new municipal stainless steel, oh wait, is that the same one? Oh, I was putting together, hold on. No, that's it. I might have grabbed the two of the same. Hold on a second. Yep. Where am I here? Is seeking a 2019 F-450 regular chassis from the Lebanon Ford located in Lebanon, Ohio. Legislation for the same was passed in early 2018 on the state procurement contract. Although the state contract has expired, the dealer had more of the same vehicles in his order bank and is willing to sell the city of Solon the same vehicle at the same contracted price. Further checking Sourcewell Cooperative Government contract, the same vehicle would cost us $2,300 more. The total cost of that chassis is $32,834, and then the additional legislation for the dump body, which we have already talked about.
We'll prepare legislation for the service department to purchase a 2019 Ford F-450 4x2 cab chassis from, what's it called? Oh, Lebanon, there it is. That's right. In the amount of $32,834.
Second that.
We have a motion and a second. Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Brings us to item number 17, our dump body accessories for the F-450.
Spoke of this earlier. The department is seeking a new stainless steel dump body with central hydraulics, electric snowplow hitch, and tailgate spreader awarded to the Concord Road Equipment of Painesville, Ohio, under the Ohio procurement contract terms. This equipment, it will be the one attached to the 2019 F-450. Total cost $37,351, and I think I spoke of this already, under budget by $15,514.
Go ahead then and make a motion to have legislation prepared authorizing the purchase of the dump body accessories for the F-450 from Concord Road Equipment in the amount of $37,351.81.
Second.
Motion and a second. Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Takes us to item number 18, the 2020 International MV-607.
I'm introducing this legislation for the water reclamation. I assisted them in speccing out and putting together a new maintainer service body crane truck for their operation. So the Solon Water Rec Department is seeking a 2020 International cab chassis equipped with a maintainer service body and crane. The vehicle replaced Water Rec's Unit 70, a 2004 F-550 service body. The new vehicle will be equipped with a wireless remote heavy-duty crane that is needed to lift at the lift stations to remove pumps in order to maintain and service them in a safe manner. Additional power equipment such as welder, generator, inverter, power tools will be on the service body in order to respond to for emergencies. The awarded vendor is the Rush Truck Center, Cincinnati, Ohio, under the Ohio Department Transportation bid contract. The The maintainer service body will be provided by the MTech Company of Oakwood, Ohio. The total cost of the vehicle body and chassis, $162,068.63.
All right, prepare legislation for the Water Reclamation Department to purchase a 2020 International MV607 and maintainer service crane body from Rush Truck Centers and MTech Company in the amount of $162,068.63.
I'll go ahead and second that.
We have a motion and a second. We'll proceed to vote.
Mr. Keturah?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmitz?
Yes.
Getting close to the end of the Mike Shimsky show.
Yes,
that
sir.
Brings us to item number 19, the 2019 Peterbilt Model 520 chassis.
Yes. The Solid Waste Division is seeking a new 2019 Peterbilt Model 520 equipped with a New Way Sidewinder XTR refuge truck purchased from the Southeastern Equipment Company of Mentor, Ohio, on the Sourcewell Government Cooperative Contract. The total budget was $350,000. The cost of the new Packer is $267,271, an under budget figure of $82,728.04.
Mrs. Meany.
Mike, how many of these trucks will we have then?
This make or?
Well, that does the pickup, that does what this one is going to do.
Seven.
Seven?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. I'll go ahead then and make a motion to have legislation prepared authorizing the purchase of a 2019 Peterbilt Model 520 chassis New Way Sidewinder XTR refuge truck in the amount of $267,271.96.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Proceed to vote.
Mr. Keturah?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmitz?
Yes.
Thanks, you for your patience and have a good evening.
Thank you.
Thanks, Mike.
That's going to bring us to item number 20, the 2017 annual materials testing contract. And
good evening,
Paul. Mr. Solonix is going to be discussing this. We're doing well.
Good, good. I just wanted to say thanks to Mike and Clint for doing such a good job specking out our truck. We got that truck back in 2004. That whole crane setup that we got on that truck was kind of new at the time, and it worked out really well for us. And unfortunately, that one was kind of undersized for the stuff that we wanted to lift for it. And Mike and Clint did a good job of upgrading the chassis of the truck and still keeping it below the CDL or the limits for the CDL. So that was very important to us, especially with our contract with the union. So I was very happy that they were able to do that. So thank you, Mike. So back to our agenda here. regards to the GSI contract, as you're aware, we extended the contract with APO Horo Contract A, moved that from December 31st to May 10th. Due to the weather, certain things that they were going to have to do that was going to extend the contract. So because of that, we also are going to need to extend the materials testing with GSI. As you recall, we extended that contract. Engineering department and construction department had the original contract with GSI, and we kind of piggybacked on that contract to do our materials testing. We added about $13,300 to that original contract and extended it to December 2018. So we're asking tonight to extend that contract again out to 2019, May 10th as well, so we can finish up any materials testing that we're gonna have with APO Oro. We're also asking to increase the amount from $80,000 to $85,000. When we looked at the amount of testing that we had, we see we're going to need about another $5,000 to make sure we're covered, to cover all that material testing.
Coming to the end, huh?
Yes.
Getting close.
Yes, we're getting there.
All right, let's prepare legislation authorizing the wastewater treatment plant to extend the contract. The contract number 2017.10 with GeoSci for the annual materials testing program from December 31st, 2018 to May 10th, 2019, and to increase the contract amount by $5,000 for a total amount of $85,000 and declaring an emergency.
We have a motion and a second. Proceed to vote.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schmitz?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So that takes us to correspondence. We have none. Other, we have none. So that will bring us to our projects reports. And item number 21, the Engineering Department Study Design Report. Mr. Dursick?
Yes. With the permits being reviewed and submitted, the Engineering Department, there were 76 permits reviewed and submitted for the month of December, and so far they've issued this year 1,881 permits. They've been meeting with BNN on several different projects for upcoming studies in the last month, and I can entertain any questions that the committee has.
Thank you. That's going to bring us to item number 22, the Construction Department Report.
Thank you. Take you right to the emergency road repair section of the report. At the beginning of December, we had a remaining balance on our emergency road repair program of $164,756. We had $56,656 in expenditures, and three of those were for road repairs at Station Street, Fountain Parkway, Solon Road, and two of them were for water department repairs at Old Harper and Aurora Road and on Woodsdale Drive that we'll be submitting for a reimbursement. That being said, it looks like my my final balance is missing here, but 164 minus 56, we basically have approximately $108,000 remaining in our emergency road repair program. Oh, I'm sorry about that, $164,756 remaining. If there's any other questions with regard to this report, the only other thing that I would add is that tomorrow we have emergency road repair scheduled on Somm Center Road, just south of the eastbound 422 exit ramp, where we'll be buttoning up that water break repair, and with MS Concrete. So in approximately 24 hours after that, we'll be able to open that back up to traffic.
Will that be on the 2019 contract?
2019 contract is going to start on March 1st.
Oh, that's right. We changed the date to March
yeah.
1st. Mrs. Meany.
Dan, so I see your little graph here. So seriously, $137,809 were for water breaks?
Yes. And
they
again,
seem like they're really happening.
There are a lot
crazy
of
crazy amount.
There are a lot
like
of
a
water
crazy,
breaks
crazy,
happening
crazy
right
amount.
Now.
I mean, I know John's not here, and I know he's been having it. Bill, I don't know if you know any of the discussions with Cleveland Water as far as what's going on here. I mean, I don't see that we're having any huge temperature. I mean, I don't know what's going on, but it seems like everywhere you look.
Yeah, I know we're still looking to have a meeting with them regarding Miles Road.
Right.
With regards to the other ones, it's I know the one on 91, that's an older main that's been there since before they widened it. Most of these, and Dan can correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe most of these are older water mains that, you know, this one happened to fail at a fluoride tester, which was a joint section, and it did a whole spiral crack around the whole pipe. But, you know, typically these things happen when we have the big changes in temperature, and it's just, I think it's just due to some age of some of the mains.
I think my only other comment, and I don't know, Mark, maybe you can echo because I know we're from that end of town, is tonight when I was coming down for the meeting, and I don't know, it's probably a little late in the game, But just a suggestion, you know, people, you know, that to me, center lane is blocked. If somehow there could be, like, whether it's cones or something, that they realize they can go into the left lane and go around it to then, because people are just sitting there and you can see coming off the freeway. And, you know, they could just go around and get back in. I guess that's just a suggestion.
Yeah, I think they may get confused because they think that might be left-hand turn, possibly.
Well, that's what I mean, but yeah. Just so people could know that they could right. do that, that they don't just have to get into the right lane. But I don't know, I just thought maybe it was a little too tight to put anything up there to...
It is a challenging message to send to drivers in that short area of space between the ramp and the water break.
Because they're coming off and it's like, boom. But I just found this number to be, you know, kind of alarming that, you know, and I hope we can get somewhere with Cleveland Water. I know that's a somewhat of a painful agency, but I mean, that we spent $137,000 that it was due to water main breaks is,
It is a lot, and it keeps this program active.
Yeah. How much of that do we anticipate we'll get back?
At every location, it's different, and the Cleveland Water Department typically dictates the size of the hole that they're willing to pay for, and we also the amount per square foot that they reimburse. So the percentages are typically less, and they're typically small compared to the cost. Though some of the breaks, you know, in a small 6x6 hole, we do very well, but in a large, you know, hole like on Miles Road, they don't reimburse very much of it.
Thank you.
Anything further on engineering department report? Okay, takes us to, I'm sorry, the construction department report. That takes us to item number 23, the 2018 annual sanitary and storm system repair program update.
I'll give a brief update on this. Mr. Gilardi's on the early shift, so he wasn't able to be here tonight. But the 2018 sanitary and storm system repair program update, the original contract amount was $400,000, as you could see. There was cost of work that was paid between January and November of $286,318.83. Cost of work invoiced in December was $5,863.35. That was for a emergency repair to a sanitary lateral at 5889 at Briar Hill. There was some current recent work that was done on Rolling Brook. As you can see on the bottom of your graph there, it says work pending. That work is actually completed. The estimated amount of that work was $50,827. I spoke with Mr. Gilardi. He told me the work was completed, and that estimate will probably, the actual cost will come down. But using that estimate, the estimated balance remaining on the contract right now is $28,353.94. And tonight, we appreciate the passage of that new contract. This work's valuable for the city and the service department. Any questions?
That takes us to item 24, the water reclamation report. Paul, anything? No visual aids.
I figured it was a long meeting. Actually, we got through it pretty quick. Just to give an update on the construction, actually over the course of the weekend, the contractor finished up with the pump station portion of that. That's more or less the pumps that will be pumping the water up to the new equalization tank. So those pumps have been set in place. That's really the major work that the contractor needed to get done. So now the rest is really left for contract B as far as getting those pumps connected, the wiring connected. So this was really his deadline was today to have those pumps installed for the electrical contractor to be able to continue work and keep on schedule. So as of right now, it looks like everything's going to be on schedule for the electrical portion of the contract. So we don't anticipate needing any time extensions for him, even though we asked for a time extension for contract E for general construction. Again, that was due to weather-related issues that he was going to have with his remaining work. So we appear to be in pretty good shape right now.
Any
Anything else you want to point out in your report?
No.
Seems like November was, must have been a wet month, right?
Yeah, we had some, as you could see, if you look at flow conditions there, that it jumped up by a significant amount, and that is due to flow. Again, when we talk about INI, inflow and infiltration, that's exactly what you see happen when we get those rain events. Again, this, as you're aware, we have had flow monitoring throughout the city trying to find out where we're getting this INI, and we address the issues as we see them, but we've never seen anything significant that we can really go after. We've done some things on Miles Road. We have a new sewer that went up there. We were hoping that that was going to alleviate some of that INI. We have yet to verify that. We've also done some things on Forest Lane as well, but we're going to do some after construction flow monitoring and see if it indicates that we made any difference in those two projects. But again, this points out the reason why we did end up going to installing an EQ tank of the size that we did is because we get these events, we've looked through the city, we can't find anything on public property where these INI issues are stemming from. But this will give us at least the equalization tank down at the plant will be able to cover these high flow situations when we experience them. And we'll have a place to be able to store that excess water and be able to hold it until the plant can treat it slowly, slowly release it back into the plant. So yes, that was a good observation. Any other questions?
So that's going to take us to item number 25, our service department report.
As the committee can see, the detailed report is in front of you for the months of November and December. I'll just make a couple of quick points to note out that the 2018 curbside leaf collection program is now completed. A total of 15,520 yards of leaves were collected curbside over a period of 71 days. Other than that, service crews are busy taking down holiday decorations, filling potholes, trying to catch up on some work with this mild weather that we've had. Very lucky, but it's coming. Salt stockpile looks good right now. Couple of new service members were just recently hired in the department. And as you can see, the holiday decorations are coming down while we have some mild weather.
That's snow away.
That's overtime down.
Yeah, that is nice.
Like that. Considering salt's so expensive.
Tom, welcome back. It's a pleasure to work with you again. Mayor, thank you for visiting with us again this evening.
My pleasure.
We always enjoy having special guests. Mrs. Meany.
Yeah. I just, you know, Mike, I'm sure it was a lot of work for you, but it really makes a lot of sense that you're bringing, I know normally, you know, I was on Public Works in the past and had a little reprieve and now I've been back on. But that you brought all of us, you know, basically this is, I think, a good chunk of your budget. So, I mean, I just think it's good probably for you to do it early and get this stuff out there and, you know, get the products and get it going. And I just thank you because I'm sure this was pretty, you know, labor intensive for you to get all of this together for us for this meeting. But, you know, Bill and I talked today. I think it's a great idea to, you know, jump on it sooner rather than later. So even though I'm sure it was a lot of work for you, I thank you for, you know, bringing all of this to us and getting, like I say, the majority of your toys purchased or out there at least to be purchased. So thank you.
Anything from the committee? Anybody?
And welcome, Tom.
Yes. Welcome back, Tom.
Mr. Driscoll.
Thank you. As you're aware, our 2019 Supplemental Inspection Services contract request for qualifications is out there, and those are due on Wednesday. Expecting that we're going to get some reasonable qualification statements and the interview process goes well next week. It's likely that I'll be requesting a special meeting prior to the January 22nd council meeting, if you'd be willing to entertain that when the time comes.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
I don't know Dan. I don't know Dan. Okay, I'll make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Roll call.
Mr. Katura?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmets?
Yes.
Adjourned.